Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've never seen a more partisan spectacle than what I've witnessed here today. Democrats want the rules to apply when it benefits them and not to apply when Republicans invoke them. 9 hours ago now, Mr. Burke, a hired gun for the Democrats, got 30 minutes to spread his partisan rhetoric and then 45 minutes to cross-examine witnesses. That's 70 minutes more than most of the members of this committee who have been elected by their districts to serve in the United States Congress. And Mr. Burke is an unelected New York lawyer specifically brought in by the Democrats to give his opinion. A politically biased consultant who has given hundreds of thousands of dollars in federal elections to the likes of ActBlue, Hillary Clinton, Obama, and Biden. Mr. Burke gave over $5,000 alone to Hillary Clinton for her presidential race. No wonder why he has an axe to grind. Mr. Burke is a white-collar criminal defense lawyer who brags on his website of getting New York financial brokers deferred prosecution for tax fraud and fund managers off for insider trading charges. And Mr. Burke was able to say whatever he wanted to say without swearing an oath to his testimony that it would be truthful. So he can sit before this committee, not as a fact witness, and directly lie to the American people without any threat of criminal prosecution. Makes sense. He's a white-collar criminal defense lawyer. I'm sure he didn't want to incriminate himself. This is the same Mr. Burke who authored a series of reports as early as October 2017, 2 years ago, on his opinion as to whether President Trump obstructed justice and colluded with Russia. He also represented Mayor Bill de Blasio in a federal investigation of de Blasio's fundraising activities. For my fellow Americans and Floridians watching this charade, this is who was sitting at the top of the dais next to the chairman acting like a member of this committee, a partisan New York lawyer with written bias against President Trump who gave thousands to Hillary Clinton's presidential campaign. And all of this spectacle, all of it, not a single fact witness has appeared in front of this committee. We have been denied a minority hearing day, which I asked for the last hearing. All we have had testify are partisan lawyers giving their opinions. So let's talk about the facts that we do have before us. We heard from Mueller. No evidence that the Trump campaign colluded or conspired with Russia to influence the 2016 election. No obstruction of justice. After denying the president to call witnesses in closed-door secret proceedings and denying Republicans from calling all their witnesses in closed-door proceedings, denying the president's counsel to cross-examine witnesses in intel hearings, the facts are this. Sondland stated when questioned, "Did the president tell you about any preconditions for anything?" His answer, no. "For the aid to be refused?" No. "For a White House meeting?" No. Ambassador Sondland also testified that President Trump wanted nothing from Ukraine. Tim Morrison, when questioned, "And there was no quid pro quo," answered, "Correct." The aid was released. Four facts never change. Both President Trump and President Zelensky say there was no pressure. The call transcript shows no conditionality between aid and an investigation. No quid pro quo. Ukrainians were not aware that aid was withheld when the president spoke. Ukraine didn't open an investigation, but still received aid in a meeting with President Trump. Mr. Castor, has any committee heard from the whistleblower, either in closed-door hearings or in open hearings?
No.
Did Chairman Schiff state that he would call the whistleblower to testify?
He did.
Has that happened?
It has not.
Is it going to occur?
I hope so.
Have other countries' aid also been held up?
Yes.
Mr. Goldman, on October 2nd, the New York Times reported that the whistleblower, quote, approached a House Intelligence Committee aide with his concerns about Mr. Trump. Is that accurate?
Sorry, say that again.
On October 2nd, the New York Times reported that the whistleblower approached a House Intelligence Committee aide with his concern about Mr. Trump. Is that accurate?
I think the whistleblower's concerns about President Trump are from the threats that
no, that's not what I'm asking. I'm asking, did the whistleblower approach a House Intelligence Committee? Let me ask it a different way. Have you had any communications with the whistleblower?
As I said earlier in response to questions from your colleagues, I'm not going to get into any delay.
So you're refusing to answer whether you've communicated with the whistleblower?
The whistleblower is not relevant to this report.
He's the whole basis of the beginning of this investigation. He's absolutely relevant.
Well,
to this committee and to the American people.
The whistleblower's complaints, for the reasons that Mr. Castor said, are not included. His allegations are not included in our report because the evidence has been outstripped and surpassed by the 17 witnesses that we have had come in to testify directly about the conduct that the whistleblower blew.
So as you sit here today, do you know the identity of the whistleblower?
Sir, I'm not going to talk to you about the identity of the whistleblower.
Because you're also refusing to answer whether you've had communications.
That's
my time, not yours. You're refusing to answer whether you had communications with the whistleblower. Has any other staff in the Intel Committee had communications with the whistleblower?
Sir, in the Intelligence
Committee. You're refusing to answer that question. And unfortunately, the American people want to know those answers, and unfortunately, my time
has expired. Congress has a right to.